Welcome back to this next video, and in this video I'm going to tell you about the possible treatment of COVID-19 by antibodies and vaccines. The first question is, what is a coronavirus? Now, coronavirus is any virus that belongs to the family coronaviridae, and this is a large family of viruses that causes illness ranging from common cold to more severe diseases like severe acute respiratory syndrome known as SARS and the Middle East respiratory syndrome known as MERS. Why they are called as the coronavirus? Because if you look at their protein spikes present on the outside of the virus, they look like crown under a microscope. Therefore, they are known as the coronavirus, as corona is Latin for crown. The coronavirus diseases, they are zoonotic. That means that they are spread from animal to humans in an event known as the spillover event. If you talk about the coronavirus, the world has already seen two such cases from this family. One is the severe acute respiratory syndrome that occurred in 2002 in China, and the possible trail from where the virus come, that was that the it transferred from a bat to the civet cats, and from cats that is transferred to the human beings. If you talk about the symptoms of the severe acute respiratory syndrome, that was a very high contagious respiratory disease characterized by the symptoms of fever, cough, the muscle ache, often with progressive difficulty in breathing. The second case that we will see from this family, that was the Middle East respiratory syndrome in 2012 in the Middle East, and it was also causing the respiratory illness with fever, cough, the shortness of breath, and some people also had diarrhea and nausea and vomiting. If you talk about the origin from where it came, again the theory is that it come from bat to the camels, and from camels it was transferred to the human beings, causing respiratory illnesses. If you talk about this novel coronavirus, in late 2019 it appeared in Wuhan in China. And the virus is named is the Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2 because of the similarity in symptoms related to the SARS that appeared in 2002. This Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome 2, or the SARS Coronavirus 2, is also known as the COVID-19, and I'll be using this term throughout this lecture. And the COVID-19, it was really similar to the SARS and was characterized primarily by fever and respiratory symptoms. And the virus, like the SARS, it was highly contagious. By early 20, it has spread throughout the region of the China, and it has reached the United States and Europe. And the theory is that how it transferred from China to the Europe and the United States is by the travelers from the affected regions. In March 2020, the World Health Organization declared the COVID-19 as a pandemic, and travel from and to within many countries was severely restricted in an effort to control its spread. In many areas, the school, the businesses, they were closed down, and the people were guided to stay at homes to prevent themselves from the COVID-19 infection. This is the general structure of the corona, the COVID-19, and if you talk about these spike proteins, they do look like the crown, and because of these spike proteins, they are known as the coronavirus. And these spike proteins, they are very important when you talk about the interaction of the virus to the human target cells, that is the lung cells. From where it came, from where the COVID-19 came, it's still a debatable matter, but the theory is that it had been transferred from the bat into the pangolins, and from the pangolins it has been transferred into the human beings. And this theory is supported by the fact that the coronaviruses that have been isolated from the pangolins, they have 96% genome similarity to COVID-19. And these pangolins, they are heavily transferred around the globe because of its scales. If you can see that these particular scales that are believed to have healing properties, and it have increased the chances of entry into the human beings because of its heavy trafficking. The genome of the COVID-19, that is a single strand positive sense RNA, and one of the studies says that it is 29,811 nucleotide longs with the adenine 29.86% adenosines, 18.39% cytosines, 19.63% guanines, and 32.12% thymines. If you talk about the target of the COVID-19, where it binds, they actually infect the cells in the lung, they multiply there, and they spread to other cells, ending in mucus for spread. So when they are in the mucus, the symptomatic person can transfer the virus of, to the non-infected person. The number of cases around the globe as of today, that is 20th July 2020, there has been more than 14 million confirmed cases around the globe, including more than 0.6 million deaths as reported by the World Health Organization. And the most affected countries in the world as of 20 July 2020, that is the United States and Brazil. In the United States, the number of cases, they are more than 3.7 million. And in Brazil, they are more than 2 million. If you talk about the current treatment of the novel coronavirus, currently there is no treatment, and the treatment is usually supportive care, providing fluids, oxygen, and ventilator support to the patient. And some of the medicines, they have been reported to work in the lab setting, including the chloroquine, which is an anti-malarial, the ritonavir, which is an antiviral, and it is also used in the HIV treatment, the remdesivir, which is an anti-Ebola and antiviral drug, and azithromycin, an antibacterial, that have also shown promising effects, especially in this part of the region. If you talk about the possible treatment of the novel coronavirus, before going into the possible treatment, you need to understand this term, because the antibody treatment that is suggested currently, that one of the biggest advantages of these antibody treatment is that they are not causing any antibody-dependent enhancement of infection. So you need to understand what is an antibody-dependent enhancement of infection. I'll use the dengue virus, the infection of the dengue virus, as an example of this. When a dengue virus that infects an individual, the immune system of that particular person is going to make antibodies against it. When these antibodies, they are formed, and that particular person is again infected by another serotype of the dengue. So what the antibodies, they do, the antibodies that are produced against the first serotype of the dengue virus, these antibodies, they bind to the dengue, the second serotype of the dengue that have now entered into the body. And these antibody and the virus complex, what they do is that they are going to attach to special receptors called as the Fc gamma receptor on the circulating monocytes. And when they do, when the antibody and the virus complex, they bind to this particular receptor, they are going to infect the monocytes really easily. And when the virus, they infect the monocyte, the outcome is an increase in the overall replication of the virus and higher risk of severe dengue infection. So the antibody that is produced against one serotype that is going to interact with the other serotype of the dengue virus, and this complex is actually increasing the severity of the disease. So this is called is the antibody dependent enhancement of the infection, because it is because of this antibody which bind to this virus, making the infection of the monocytes very easy, increasing the viral load in the cells, a viral load in the body, thereby causing a high level of the disease. So this is known as the antibody dependent enhancement of the infection. Now, if you talk about the antibodies that are in the trial these days, one of the antibody is known as the Covishield. Now, this Covishield is developed by one of the biotechnology company known as the Sorrento Therapeutics. And the Sorrento Therapeutics, they have developed the neutralizing antibody cocktail. and this cocktail is going to bind to distant epitopes on the COVID-19 spike proteins. The important thing about this cocktail antibody is that it is creating a barrier to the emergence of the resistant variants in treated individuals. And the most important thing about the COVID-Shield is that the Fc regions, they are so engineered that they are not going to interact with the Fc receptor of the host, thereby decreasing the risk of antibody-dependent enhancements of COVID-19 infection. This is how it looks. When the virus that is there, there is no antibody, the virus is going to interact with this special receptor on the lung cells known as the ACE2 receptor, and when they attach to it, they are going to enter the cell, multiplying them. In the presence of the COVID-Shield, you are actually using three neutralizing monoclonal antibodies, therefore we call this as a cocktail of the antibodies. These three neutralizing monoclonal antibodies are going to attach to three distant epitopes, and when they bind them, they are not going to allow the interaction of the virus to the ACE2 receptor, therefore there is a full antiviral blockade of the virus. And the important thing, as I've told you, there is no antibody dependent enhancement of the disease, because the COVID-Shield monoclonal antibodies, they do not bind to the host Fc receptors. Another antibody that is developed again by the Sorrento Therapeutics, that is known as the COVID TRAPT. And what this COVID TRAPT do is that it has demonstrated antiviral efficacy in vitro cell culture methods of the COVID-19 infection. And it is being developed to treat the COVID-19 without the risk of antibody-dependent enhancement of infection, because this particular phenomena, the antibody-dependent enhancement of infection in case of the monoclonal antibodies, it sometimes, as I've told you, in the case of the dengue, they can actually increase the risk of the disease. But these antibodies that are developed by the Sorrento Therapeutics, they are actually focusing on the on this particular phenomena, that these antibodies do not cause any antibody-dependent enhancement of infection by genetically engineering the antibodies. Now, the Fc portion of the COVID trap molecule is engineered to abrogate interaction with the Fc receptor of the immune cells, thereby decreasing the ADE. If you look at this one, this is the virus. If there is no treatment of the antibody, the virus is going to interact with the ACE2 receptor present on the lung cells. This ACE2 receptor is actually the angiotensin converting enzyme 2, and for short, it is known as the ACE2. Now, what the COVID trap do is that it is going to interact with the proteins present on the surface of the virus, and when they do, the viruses, they do not have the ability to interact with the ACE2 receptor, and when the virus cannot interact with the ACE2 receptor, there is an antiviral blockade, because the virus, they cannot enter into the cell, they cannot take over the machinery of the cell, they cannot replicate over there, they cannot make more copies of it, thereby there is a complete antiviral blockade. The third type of the neutralizing antibody developed by the Sorrento Therapeutic is known as the CoviGuard. And this is a neutralizing antibody which binds to the S1 subunit of the spike proteins of COVID-19. Again, as I've told you, one of the important things about these antibodies is that these antibodies have been engineered, and when they are so engineered that they do not interact with the host Fc receptor, therefore decreasing the risk of the antibody-dependent enhancements of the COVID-19 infections. Now, all of these three antibodies, they are still in the clinical trials, but the result in the lab, they are very promising, and they may be in the near future treatment for the COVID-19 infection. This is how this works, that if there is an infection of the virus without any antibody, they are going to interact with the ACE2, therefore they are causing the disease. What these neutralizing antibody do, this CoviGuard, what it do is that it is going to interact with the S1 subunit of the spike proteins, and when they do, the virus is no more able to interact with the ACE2 receptor. Therefore, there is a full antiviral blockade, and against no antibody dependent enhancement of the disease. If you talk about the vaccines, before going into the vaccine, you need to understand what is a vaccine. So a vaccine is a biological preparation that provide active acquired immunity to a particular infectious diseases. And a vaccine typically contain an agent that resemble a disease-causing microorganism, and is often made from the weakened or killed form of the microbes, its toxins, or one of its surface proteins. One of the important vaccine that have been that has produced very good results in trials is known as the CHADOX1 vaccine, developed by the Oxford University, and that's being developed at an unprecedented speed. What this virus contains is that it is made from a genetically engineered virus that causes the common cold in chimpanzee. But this virus has been genetically engineered, and it has been heavily modified, and it has been so modified that it cannot cause infection in people. And it is actually engineered by transferring the genetic instruction for the coronavirus spikes protein, and these spike protein, they are very important to invade the cells of the human beings, the lung cells of the human beings. So the vaccines they are developing, they're actually focusing on these spike proteins. So these viruses, the genetically engineered viruses, they are actually expressing the spike proteins on their surfaces, but they are so engineered that they do not cause the disease, but your immune system do develop antibody against these spike proteins, thereby providing immune system, thereby giving the immune system to learn how to attack the original COVID-19 virus. The trials that have been conducted on about 1,100 people, and they showed that the injection lead them to making antibodies and T cells that can fight coronavirus. And if a vaccine can make the antibodies, and if can make T cells, that means it has the potential to fight that particular virus. Now these findings, they are hugely promising, but it's still too soon to know if this is enough to offer protection, and larger trials, they are still underway, but the initial trials, they are producing very promising results. And in the UK, about 100 million doses of vaccines that has already been ordered. The reason behind the vaccines, that why they are developed in a very huge time, is that if you talk about the vaccines, I think we have to wait a little longer for something that we can for sure see is effective. And the reason for this is that the science and medicine, they need time. We have to do a lot of trials before the vaccines or the drugs can be actually used for the human beings. In the end, I would like to appreciate the efforts of the medical staff, the paramedical staff, the scientists, all of the individuals that are involved in this crisis of the pandemics to find a solution to this particular pandemic. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and share this video with your friends and colleagues.